Good morning. This is my review of Unit 6, Energy and Momentum of Rotating Systems for AP Physics 1.
Flippin' Physics!
This video is a free portion of my AP Physics 1 Ultimate Review Packet. If you are enrolled in AP Physics 1 this year, I definitely recommend that you get my full AP Physics 1 Ultimate Review Packet as well. Link is in the video description. Billy, tell me what you know about translational kinetic energy and therefore also rotational kinetic energy.
Absolutely. The equation for translational kinetic energy is 1/2 mass times speed squared. And the equation for rotational kinetic energy is 1/2 rotational inertia times angular speed squared. From that, you can see that the rotational inertia is the rotational equivalent of mass, and the angular speed is the rotational equivalent of speed. And while it looks like V and omega are velocities, technically, in the kinetic energy equations, they are speeds. And rotational kinetic energy is a scalar, just like all other forms of work and energy. And the total kinetic energy of a rigid object is the addition of its rotational kinetic energy about its center of mass and its translational kinetic energy from the linear motion of its center of mass. That is what I remember.
Well done, Billy. Now let's talk about torque and work. And realize, like Billy just did with translational and rotational kinetic energies, when it comes to rotating systems, we usually start by reviewing the linear form first and then translating that into a rotational form. For example, a force can transfer energy into or out of a system if the force acts over a change in position or a displacement. Bo, please translate that into rotational terms.
Sure. A torque can transfer energy into or out of a rigid system if the torque acts over a change in angular position or angular displacement.
And what are the equations?
The equation for work done by a force on a system is work equals force times displacement times the cosine of the angle between those two directions. And the equation for work done by a torque on a rigid system is work equals torque times angular displacement times, well, actually in AP Physics 1, torque and angular displacement are either clockwise or counterclockwise in direction. So we do not need that cosine theta in the equation. Right, Mr. P?
No, we do not. However, we do need to be careful to recognize that if the torque and angular displacement are in the same direction, the work done by the torque on the object is positive, and if the torque and angular displacement are in opposite directions, the work done by the torque on the object is negative. Bo, what about work and a graph of force as a function of position?
On a graph of force as a function of position, work is the area under the curve.
Where area above the horizontal position axis is positive and area below the horizontal position axis is negative.
Of course.
It's called the signed area.
Yeah.
Yeah, so on a graph of torque as a function of angular position, work is the signed area under the curve.
Yep. Yeah.
Well done, Bo. Bobby, please do the same thing Bo just did, only for linear momentum.
Okay, just like an object can have linear momentum, lowercase p, an object can have angular momentum, uppercase L.
Neither of the letter choices for those variables makes sense.
Okay. Linear momentum equals mass times velocity, where linear momentum and velocity are vectors. Angular momentum equals rotational inertia times angular velocity, where angular momentum and angular velocity are vectors. Actually, unlike linear momentum, there are two equations for angular momentum, and the one I just gave you is for the angular momentum of a rigid object with shape. And the angular momentum of a rigid object with shape has to be relative to an axis of rotation, and the angular momentum of a point particle is rmv sine theta, where r is the distance from axis of rotation, or reference point to the point particle, m is the mass of the particle, V is the magnitude of the velocity of the point particle, and theta is the angle between R and V. And it's good to point out that the angular momentum of a point particle has to be relative to an axis of rotation, which is sometimes also called a reference point. And this equation is for the magnitude of the angular momentum of a point particle. And just like linear momentum, angular momentum is a vector. It has both magnitude and direction. In AP Physics 1, we use clockwise and counterclockwise to indicate the direction of angular momentum. And the units for angular momentum are kilograms times meters squared over seconds. It's relatively easy to see that from the angular momentum of a point particle equation. The units are meters times kilograms times meters per second, which works out to be kilograms times meters squared over seconds. That's what I remember.
Well done.
Thanks.
Yeah. We've expressed Newton's second law in two ways. Net force equals mass times acceleration, and net force equals change in momentum over change in time. The rotational form of Newton's second law can also be expressed in two ways. Net torque equals rotational inertia times angular acceleration, and net torque equals change in angular momentum over change in time. Now, a rotational form of Newton's second law can be used to find angular impulse. Net torque equals change in angular momentum over change in time can be rearranged to get change in angular momentum equals torque times change in time. Realize this derivation assumes the torque causing the angular impulse is much, much larger than all other torques acting on the system, and therefore the net torque equals the torque causing the angular impulse. Also, you can see from the equation that because angular impulse and torque are vectors, the direction of angular impulse is the same as the direction of the net torque acting on the system. So, that's two of the things angular impulse is equal to. However, there are actually three. But let's go back for a moment to linear impulse. Bo, what are the three things linear impulse is equal to?
Linear impulse equals change in linear momentum, and it equals the force causing the impulse times change in time. And again, we are assuming the force causing impulse, or what we often call the impact force, is much, much larger than all other forces, making the impact force equal to the net force. And linear impulse also equals the signed area under an impact force versus time curve.
And what are the three things angular impulse is equal to?
Angular impulse equals change in angular momentum, torque. Actually, can we call that impact torque because it is the torque acting on the system during a collision?
Sure. Impact torque. That works.
So, angular impulse equals change in angular momentum, impact torque times change in time, and the area under an impact torque versus time curve.
Thank you, Bo. I will also point out that when given an impact force, or impact torque as a function of time graph, it is not unusual to use the average impact force or average impact torque and change in time to determine the impulse, because that makes the area into a rectangle, and it is generally much easier mathematically to determine the area of a rectangle. And realize, because on a graph of linear momentum as a function of time, the slope of the curve is the net force acting on the object. Therefore, on a graph of angular momentum as a function of time, the slope of the curve is the net torque acting on the object. And now let's talk about conservation of angular momentum. But before we do, Billy, please show us the derivation for when the linear momentum of a system remains constant.
Absolutely. The net force on a system equals the change in linear momentum of a system divided by change in time. If the net force on a system equals zero, then the change in linear momentum of the system equals zero, and the change in linear momentum of a system equals final linear momentum of the system minus initial linear momentum of the system. Therefore, the final linear momentum of the system equals the initial linear momentum of the system. Another way to say that is that the sum of the final linear momenta equals the sum of the initial linear momenta.
Thank you, Billy. Bo, please do the same thing, only for when the angular momentum of a system remains constant.
I'm just going to say exactly what Billy just said, only changing force to torque and linear to angular, right?
True, however, it is still helpful to hear you say it.
Fine, I'll do it.
Absolutely. The net torque on a system equals the change in angular momentum of a system divided by change in time. If the net torque on a system equals zero, then the change in angular momentum of the system equals zero, and the change in angular momentum of the system equals final angular momentum of the system minus initial angular momentum of the system. Therefore, the final angular momentum of the system equals the initial angular momentum of the system. Another way to say that is that the sum of the final angular momenta equals the sum of the initial angular momenta.
What?
Thank you, Bo. A simple demonstration of this involves me rotating with my arms outstretched while holding two masses. Angular momentum of the system equals rotational inertia times angular velocity. Therefore, when I pull both of my arms in, I decrease the distance those masses are from the axis of rotation, and therefore decrease my rotational inertia. However, There is no external torque acting on the system, therefore the angular momentum of the system remains the same. And the angular velocity of the system increases. Again, this is because there is no external torque acting on the system, therefore the angular momentum of the system remains constant because there is no angular momentum being added or removed from the system. And if I instead push off of something, I cause a non-zero torque on the system. Angular momentum does not remain the same because angular momentum has been added to the system. In other words, angular momentum is transferred between the system and the environment when there is a net torque acting on the system. Okay, Newton's third law, which is an equation, states that the force exerted by object 1 on object 2 is equal and opposite to the force exerted by object 2 on object 1. And there is a rotational form of Newton's third law, which is also an equation, which states that about an axis of rotation, the torque exerted by object 1 on object 2 is equal and opposite to the torque exerted by object 2 on object 1. And because those two torques must act during the same time interval for both objects, we can multiply both sides of the equation by change in time. And torque times change in time is angular impulse. Therefore, we know that about an axis of rotation, the angular impulse exerted by object 1 on object 2 is equal and opposite to the angular impulse exerted by object 2 on object 1. All right, class, tell me what you know about rolling without slipping.
Absolutely. A rigid object with shape, which is rolling without slipping, has equations for displacement, velocity, and acceleration of its center of mass, which are very similar to the circular motion equations for arc length, tangential velocity, and tangential acceleration. For example, in circular motion, arc length equals radius times angular displacement, and in rolling without slipping, the displacement of the center of mass of the object equals the radius of the object times angular displacement.
In circular motion, tangential velocity equals radius times angular velocity. And in rolling without slipping, the velocity of the center of mass of the object equals the radius of the object times its angular velocity.
And in circular motion, tangential acceleration equals radius times angular acceleration. And in rolling without slipping, the acceleration of the center of mass of the object equals the radius of the object times its angular acceleration.
And r is lowercase for circular motion because it represents the distance from the axis of rotation to the location of the linear quantity, arc length, tangential velocity, or tangential acceleration. And because that location could be anywhere on the object, lowercase r is a variable.
R is uppercase for rolling without slipping because it represents the radius of the rigid object with shape, which is constant.
When an object is rolling without slipping, it has both translational and rotational kinetic energies.
I cannot think of anything else.
Nope.
Y'all remembered plenty. However, there are a few more things which I will go over. In an ideal case, when an object is rolling without slipping, the force of static friction acting on the object does not dissipate energy from the object. In other words, the force of static friction does not do any work on the object. Also, the acceleration of a rigid object with shape rolling without slipping down an incline only depends on three variables: the incline angle, the gravitational field, and the factor in front of mass times radius squared in the rotational inertia equation. In other words, if you have a solid sphere and a solid cylinder both rolling down the same incline, the solid sphere will have a larger acceleration down the incline than the solid cylinder. This is because less of the gravitational potential energy of the solid sphere will be converted to rotational kinetic energy, leaving more translational kinetic energy in the solid sphere.
What?
Yeah.
Remember, we derived the acceleration of a solid cylinder down an incline? The rotational inertia of a solid cylinder is one half the mass of the cylinder times the radius of the cylinder squared. Mechanical energy of the Earth and cylinder system stays constant while the cylinder rolls down the incline. The system starts with all gravitational potential energy and ends with both translational and rotational kinetic energies. The acceleration of the solid cylinder down the incline worked out to be 2/3 gravitational field strength times the sine of the incline angle. The mass and the radius of the cylinder dropped out of the equation, and all we were left with was gravitational field strength, the incline angle, and the fraction in front of the equation.
Yeah, and that fraction was determined by the factor in front of mass times radius squared in the rotational inertia equation. With other objects rolling down the incline, the larger the fraction in front of mass times radius squared in the rotational inertia equation, the more amount of gravitational potential energy that is converted to rotational kinetic energy, and not translational kinetic energy, and the smaller the acceleration of the object.
And we do not even need to know the rotational inertia equations of the objects to be able to compare their accelerations down the incline. The larger the percentage of the mass of the object which is farther from the axis of rotation through its center of mass of the object, the larger the factor will be in front of mass times radius squared in the rotational inertia equation, and the more rotational kinetic energy the object will have, and therefore the less translational kinetic energy that the object will have, and the slower the acceleration. So for the example that we did with a thin metal hoop, hollow blue racquetball, and yellow lacrosse ball, the thin metal hoop has the largest percentage of mass located farthest from its center of mass, so it has the smallest acceleration and will reach the bottom last. The solid yellow lacrosse ball has the largest percentage of mass located closest to its center of mass, so it has the largest acceleration and will reach the bottom first. And the hollow blue racquetball is in the middle and reaches the bottom after the yellow ball, but before the metal hoop.
And that is exactly what happened.
Yep.
Yes, it is.
Agreed. Thanks for clarifying that. Now, when an object is rolling with slipping, the equations for rolling without slipping are no longer valid. For example, the velocity of the center of mass of an object rolling with slipping does not equal the radius of the object times its angular velocity. And with regards to energy and work, when an object is rolling with slipping on a surface, the point of application of force of kinetic friction on the object moves with respect to the surface. Therefore, the force of kinetic friction does dissipate energy from the object. The force of kinetic friction does work on the object. Okay, now let's discuss the motion of orbiting satellites. When a system is comprised of a massive central object and a much smaller orbiting satellite, the center of mass of the system is considered to be the center of mass of the central object, and the central object is considered to not move relative to the center of mass of the system. In circular orbits, each of the following remain constant: the total mechanical energy of the system, the gravitational potential energy of the system, the angular momentum of the satellite, and the kinetic energy of the satellite. And in elliptical orbits, it's a little bit different. The total mechanical energy of the system and the angular momentum of the satellite remain constant. However, the gravitational potential energy of the system and the kinetic energy of the satellite do not remain constant. Now, when a satellite is in either an elliptical orbit or a circular orbit, its linear momentum does not remain constant because the direction of its velocity changes. However, the angular momentum of the satellite does not change, and the direction of its angular velocity does remain constant.
Oh, that is because the net force acting on a satellite is non-zero. It has a net force acting on it in the indirection called the centripetal force.
For a satellite in orbit, the only force acting on the satellite is the inward force of gravity pulling it toward the planet. So the net force in the indirection, the centripetal force, is the force of gravity.
Yeah, so the satellite does have a net force acting on it in the indirection. However, the net torque acting on the satellite about the center of mass and axis of rotation of the planet is zero because the net force acts in a direction toward the axis of rotation, the center of mass of the planet, and causes zero net torque on the satellite.
Exactly. And lastly, escape velocity is the minimum speed an object needs such that the final velocity of the object will be zero when the object is an infinite distance from a planet.
So escape velocity is defined as the minimum speed necessary to escape the gravitational pull of a planet, right?
Sort of. It's more like the escape velocity of a planet is the minimum speed at which an object can be launched such that it would take an infinite amount of time for the gravitational pull of the planet to slow the object to a stop.
Oh, right. Or such that the object would not fall back down to the surface of the planet.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. And realize escape velocity ignores any frictional effects caused by the atmosphere of the planet. You should definitely know how to derive the escape velocity of an object, which we have, of course, already done. And you are welcome to look over our escape velocity derivation video if you need a refresher on that. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.